Hey guys, welcome to the show. Today we're talking about everything you can imagine about tea. So feel free to ask any kind of questions as we start this. I'll probably repeat that as people are joining on here. But as you know, this is the Dr. G Show, and every week we talk about some new topic, and I'll kind of let you guys drive the conversation too as we go. So feel free to ask questions and talk about what you want. Last week, I think we had technical issues, but I do this with my phone, and it's kind of messing up sometimes, so we're going to have to figure that out. But otherwise, all of these are also queued on Facebook under video, under my videos, on my Facebook page, and so there's probably like 80 different videos that we've done over the last year and a half. So you can always go back and watch the old ones too. Kaylin's there, how you doing? And so with tea, there's a lot of good stuff about tea. And what's funny is the way that we kind of conceptualize tea may be a little different from what tea really is. And all tea, basically all herbs and even spices, can be teas. So tea isn't just tea leaves from the tea plant, but really you can make almost anything into tea. So all herbals can be tea. So you can drink a basil tea. There's Carolyn, and you know, basil tea, or I was thinking like chamomile tea. So some people are used to those. But I want to talk today about kind of the process of it too. So I always like to know, like I watch a show called How's It Made. And so I always want to know how everything's made, the whole process, everything. And it's amazing how much I did not know about tea. But I went to a presentation years ago with Janet Jackson, of all people. But she's an acupuncturist from Newton. And she actually, I mean, that was an amazing presentation, all the stuff I didn't know. So we'll talk a little bit about like the types of tea, the production of tea, grading teas, maybe the history of tea, preparation, all this kind of things, and then also health benefits. And then as you guys have questions, feel free to post those too, even if we go off topic just a little bit. So I'm okay with that sometimes, right? So hey Tim, glad to have you here. So first let's talk about kind of tea. And typical type of tea, like green tea, black tea, oolong tea, all they do is they take that tea plant and they take the top two or three leaves and then they throw it in their basket. So really all those kind of teas from color wise are all the actual same tea. They're the same tea plant. And then they're picked twice a year during like spring or during like summer. And from there they go through this processing. And so if the tea, I mean the very first tea that comes out from those leaves, that would be like yellow tea or white tea. The longer that tea oxidizes for, the darker color it becomes and the more caffeine. So like a white tea and a yellow tea might be about 15 milligrams of caffeine, which is like about half of what soda is or half of what chocolate is, right? And then a green tea is about 25 milligrams of caffeine. So that little bit of oxidation that takes place between white tea, yellow tea, and green tea almost doubles that caffeine content. But chocolate is like 35 milligrams of caffeine, which is the same as soda. So most people don't think of them being the same caffeine content. So you might do coffee, or you might do chocolate, but oh, don't drink soda because it has too much caffeine, but it's the same thing. But after it's fully oxidized, it becomes black tea. And black tea is actually 50 milligrams of caffeine. So 50, or let's say about 35, is where you start seeing things like anxiety stemming from too much caffeine. And it's not a cup of black tea. It's 44 ounce of black tea or 32 ounce of black tea at Quick Trip or something like that. That's where you start seeing issues because it takes about 350 milligrams of caffeine to start causing anxiety. And if there's anxiety for no reason, we'll call it general anxiety disorder. But most people's general anxiety is just dietary induced. There's high glycemia will do that, caffeine will do that. So that black tea is 50 milligrams for a little cup, right? And then yerba mate, which is like a South American kind of energy tea, that one is about 85 milligrams of caffeine, the same as like a Red Bull. And don't do Red Bull, that's just chemical nightmare. But if you're going to do one, do yerba mate. Like, it's an herbal tea. It's good for you, but it does have a lot of caffeine. So a little bit for, like, you know, you had a hard night or something, you have too many kids or life just gets in the way. Once in a while, that's okay. But if you're drinking yerba mate all the time, then you have a problem, right? You got to fix the lifestyle part. And I used to have a yerba mate cacao that I bought at the health food store. And so it's got a little hint of kind of chocolate flavor to it. And then it has that caffeine, so it was probably banking on about 100 milligrams of caffeine, which is right around where coffee is. So coffee's 100 to 200 milligrams of caffeine for a little cup. So when we talked about that 350 milligrams of caffeine, well, your Starbucks Venti Mocha or whatever, hell yeah, you should have anxiety all day long from that. So, you know, a little cup of coffee once in a while is okay, but your black tea, one cup, not so bad, but that green tea, you can drink quite a bit of that and not have problems, or white tea or yellow tea. So the production of tea, I mean, basically what they do is they do wilting and then they do withering, which is, you know, they put them on big baskets, or not baskets, are these flat little bamboo kind of basket things, and then they put it out in the sun and they start to let it oxidize. So, you know, it's that green leaf, and then the more it starts to wilt, it'll start slowly oxidating, which will release a bit more caffeine, like we said. It'll also release some amino acids and tannins. And so white tea, yellow tea, and green tea will have very different flavors, especially compared to something that's fully oxidized like black tea. And as you guys join us too, feel free to ask questions. This is interactive. This is your time, right? So I have my little agenda of like information that I want to get to you guys. But really, if you have questions, let me know. And I don't mind jumping around either, okay? So this is your, I do the live show, but really it's for you guys. And there's Carol. She's drinking tea and watching Dr. G, which rhymes. But what kind of tea are you drinking, Carol? And if you guys drink tea, what is the kind of tea that you prefer? And also, what about herbal teas? What kind of herbal teas do you like? There's a few, we'll see what people recommend, but holy crap, there's some really potent, great ones for you. And Suzanne, howdy, how you doing? So when it oxidizes in that kind of withering or wilting phase, just out in the sun, that's starting to release a little bit of this tannins and caffeine that change how it is. So Suzanne roasted dandelion. So no, that's really good. Dandelion root tea, that's really great. And even like the heads of the dandelion, you can even make liquor out of that. And then the stems you can use as medicine. Hey, Diane. Diana, so Diana Nelson says, what tea do you recommend for anemia? Iron tea? Is that a thing? You take the letter T and you cut it out of steel, and then you put that in your teacup, and that releases iron. That's a good question. The question is really, why do you have low iron? Maybe blood tea? Vampire tea? I don't know. That's a good one. So iron, okay, so no, okay, we got it. Okay, so iron absorption is typically from greens. But fruits, like vitamin C, those vitamins from there, will actually help absorb iron. So if you're eating a salad, drink a citrus tea, like lemon or orange, and that will help pull in the iron to make it more absorbable for you. So that's one of the cool things, like you always put fruit with your salad so you absorb more iron that way too. And then Diana Nelson says genetics. Is that a question? But I'll tell you this, though. So I've had the opportunity to help reverse two fatal genetic patients, right? One had leukemia, one had multiple myeloma, but we were able to reverse the genetics of that mutation back to 100% normal XY karyotype, which is pretty freaking amazing. But green tea will help do that. That's one of the things that we really use for that. And so theophylline in there, in the epigallic acid, literally changes your DNA or your genetics. So Diana Nelson, like, that's a great point. It's like truly changing genetics, where, say, black tea might cause more problems than benefit. And Dave, what did it say? I'm sorry, let me move this back down. Oh, crap, there's too many people. Licorice tea? Oh, yeah, so licorice tree, so it's licorice root, and licorice root is a really good adaptogen, and that actually helps regulate your cortisol. So licorice tea is really great for that. And then Jenny says black strap molasses. Yeah, so, you know, that's true. If you put that, you could put that as your sugar in there, and that would help raise iron content too. And they have magnesium in there, manganese, and B vitamins, which would be great. So, yeah, no, that's very good. And there's Zoe. And I think Zoe knows some tea stuff too. I think she trained with that. So, the oxidation changes that. And you know, the same thing about, like, the cooking temperatures. I know my friend Sonia, you know, she has, like, a tea kettle that actually will change the temperature. And so, most people don't know that how you cook tea or boil tea makes a huge difference. So Donna says, what about black licorice is just anise with wheat, and that causes cortisol problems, or that'll cause lots of problems. But licorice root as an herb, or as a root, medicinal, that actually helps your cortisol. So not the candy. And Carol says she's drinking freshly brewed loose tea. It's probably like a gunpowder tea there. Chamomile and peppermint. That's a good one. Which is funny, because chamomile relaxes you, and then peppermint stimulates you. So peppermint's a really great one to smell, and it actually stimulates brain function and memory. But chamomile's very relaxing. I have this food sensitivity to green tea, and I don't like to drink black tea because it's oxidized. So I haven't found... I gotta find some white tea to drink, but so I got some chamomile lemon, and holy crap, I'm too chilled already. You might not notice that, but I'm very, like, relaxed a lot of time, most of the time, right? And I would drink that, and I'd just come to work and just be like, just too relaxed. So I can't drink the chamomile tea because it's too chill. The same thing's true about Yogi bedtime tea. That's a fabulous one for helping you go to sleep. It has a bunch of adaptogens, like the licorice root that everybody keeps talking about. And that one, my friend took it away from me during the day. I was super stressed, like, this was months ago, and it's too much. So they gave me some of that to drink, and then I was just, like, too relaxed. Like, it really calmed me down. So with that, it works really well. I mean, and there's a yogi stress relief tea that has a few of those adaptogens in there, too. And then Suzanne talks about adding lemon reduces the amount, changes on it. Exactly, yeah. So the same thing. Yeah, lemon, that's really good in your tea. So one of the things about cooking times. So if you cook tea too hot, it'll make it change the flavor and often be more bitter. So some people don't like tea because of the taste. So typically what you want to do, and even how long you leave the tea bag in there. So there's the right way to do it, and then there's the guy way to do it. And the guy way to do it is usually the wrong way, but it's just what I do. It's a little bit different, but, and Donna's like orange spice. That's really good in there too. And you know, adding those will help. So you don't have to add sweetener to it also, which is wonderful. So white tea is about 149 degrees to about 159 degrees, somewhere in there. So very low heat with that. And then you only steep the tea bag in there for 1 to 2 minutes. And that's true for white tea, yellow tea, and green tea. It's only about 2 minutes, and then you're supposed to, you have that little spatula thing, you squeeze the tea bag, and then you put it up next to you, or you can take, you just put it on your spoon and then squeeze it with your thumb, which is the, I don't know, I was going to say the ghetto version here, but that's the ghetto way to do it, is you just do it with your thumb, your dirty thumb, put it back in there, and then, you know, if you have your loose tea, then you just kind of tap that thing and put it to the side. But 1 to 2 minutes is your steep time. Now, is that what I do? No. I just put it in there forever. So I just leave it the whole damn time. I tie the little string around the handle, and I just leave it in there. So it's not the right way, but it's the way. And then yellow tea is about 158 degrees to 168. So 148 to 158 for white. And then we go up 10 degrees for yellow tea. And then green tea is the next set. So that's your 168, 178 temperature. And that really makes sure that you don't overcook the tea. So the milder the tea is, the less heat you want to use with that. And then with oolong tea, it's the next. So then it's the 178, 188. And oolong, again, is the same thing as green tea, or yellow tea, white tea, black tea. And oolong's the one that you often see for like, oh, that's going to be a weight loss tea, and it's not. It's just tea. If you have a healthy diet, that's how you lose weight. You can't just eat crap and then drink some oolong and think it's going to work for you. Yeah. So Donna says that's how the English do it, with the spoon, but not the thumb. So, yeah. And then, after oolong tea, you have your black tea. And black tea uses the highest heat. So that's like 210. It's already oxidized. You can cook it really hot. And about 210 degrees, roughly, that's going to be your full temperature for that. Again, 2 to 3 minutes. So the white, yellow, and green is 1 to 2 minutes for steeping. But the more oxidized is 2 to 3 minutes. And then you take that out. And Carolyn says she loves the stash Moroccan. Oh my God, Moroccan mint is like the best. Just great. It drives brain function, memory, alertness. You're more productive when you drink that. But the Moroccan mint is great. I even would mix that sometimes with green tea also. So, yeah, she had a sensitivity to the green tea like I did. So Moroccan mint. But I also had a reaction to mint. So, you know. Yeah, so that's good. And then, so your black tea's 210, 2 to 3 minutes, and then you have your herbal teas. And herbal teas are about the same temperature you do as like a black tea. So it's about 210 degrees. And then, you know, 3 to 6 minutes. Now, the other nice thing about tea, so, you know, what tea should you buy? And I always tell people about, you know, like your waist up on the shelves. So anything above Celestial Seasoning basically is a good tea. And you just want to make sure there's no other crap that's in there. So with that, you like your Stash, your Nomi, your Triple Leaf, Yogi Tea, that's always, those are your medicinal types of teas. So those are your better quality teas when it comes to that. Usually like $2 to $5 a box. And then you have things like matcha tea. And matcha tea is like powderized tea. And then you have sencha tea. And sencha and matcha are both powders typically. They don't have to be, but they typically are powders. Matcha is what you see in like traditional Japanese tea ceremonies. Like it'll be very expensive, but you don't really need much at all. Also, like if you go to Wasabi, I always get the green tea. And it's matcha tea. And matcha is grown covered up, where sencha is not. So think about like sometimes in the summer people put those white sheets over the tomato plants, and that way the sun's not directly just beating down on those and killing them. So that's how sencha is direct sun. So I always think S sun. So that's direct. It's going to have more nutrients and more bioflavonoids, more nutrition there. But it's also going to have stronger flavor. And then matcha is covered up. So matcha is going to have a little bit milder taste, which is why they use it for ceremonies. So, but again, if matcha is too expensive or Essentia is too expensive, just get your, you know, your stash or your yogi or something like that. Hey, Pandora. Glad you joined us. Tell us what kind of tea you like to drink, too. So those are those temperatures. So there's teapots that you can buy that have the programmable temperature in there, even at Walmart, or, you know, you don't have to pay a whole lot for those. That's really nice. Otherwise, you just kind of get used to what the temperature is, and you kind of know about what it is. I have a glass teapot that I do that's automatic. You push the button. I just got it from Walmart. But it has LED that light up, so it's nice. This blue hue. It's really pretty. And so the automatically shuts off, too, so you don't burn it like you would stovetop. If that helps. And then Carol says... there's also a woman-owned local tea company called Cozy Leaf Tea. Yeah, that's true. Woman-owned. And so you can purchase their stuff locally, too. And that's great. And it's nice to support local also. So Zoe says, can drinking tea every day have negative health consequences? Only if the consequences are like, oh, I feel too good, or like I'm thinking too clearly. But... it's true medicine, so it's like herbal medicine. So you really want that all the time. Now, if you're drinking black tea in large amounts because your hormones suck and you have to have that much caffeine to survive, that's problematic. But otherwise, it is how most of the world gets their medicine every day. So that's a wonderful delivery system for that. And what's funny is they actually make green tea pills, right? And so they're capsules. And I thought it was hilarious. So I read the reviews on it. And they had a Indian scientist that was supposed to critique it. And they said, what do you think about this? And he said, well, if you're too damn lazy to boil some water, yeah, it's a good idea. But that's funny, because that's that American like, oh, boil water to make tea, that's too much work. Can I just take a pill, right? Can I just take a pill? The other thing, too, with this, and let me go back to this one question, Suzanne's. I've had traditional green tea prepared by Japanese women. Oh, well, la-di-da, Suzanne. Woo. So, she's all highfalutin here. So, yeah, I went to a tea ceremony, too. But, yeah, it's unbelievable. It really is good. And it's really interesting, the tea ceremonies, because it's this whole process. We tried to get one for a ceremony for a whole bunch of, like, patients and stuff, and like they could participate, but we couldn't find anybody that could do it. So, no, that's awesome. And Suzanne, that's a great experience too. And that truly, you know, like the history of tea is tea was really originally religious, and then it was for the affluent. And so we don't want poor people drinking tea. That's crazy. That we can't have the bourgeois doing that. And then by the time it ended up in England, I think maybe the 1800s, it became like everybody drank tea. And so it's kind of interesting, if you look at the history of tea, it was religious, and then it was highfalutin, and then it became, and then it moved across the, as it started spreading around the world, then it became really just more of a high class thing, and then it became bourgeois. And so then it just, everybody drank green tea. But what's funny is the green tea, like even the Boston Tea Party, most people don't think about that being green tea. So that first Boston Tea Party was green tea. And we all drank green tea. And then America bombed Japan. And then they became jerks about selling green tea. So then we started buying our tea from India, which was an ally. But it was oxidized green tea. And so then we ended up switching to black tea. And then once the war was over and everybody made friends, we didn't switch back to green tea. And black tea is fully oxidized, and the whole process of aging is oxidation. And so you'll see where, you know, black tea is has medicinal effects. But it's kind of like taking, I always like the example, you take an apple, cut it in half, that's green tea, white tea, yellow tea. That's healthy, that's going to reverse disease, that's anti-aging medicine. If you find that apple 2 weeks later and it's black and gooey, that's black tea, fully oxidized. Now, it might have medicinal effects, but nobody wants to eat that black, gooey apple. So we went green, white, yellow tea as our main staples. Oh, and the Killian says like honeybush rooibos. Now rooibos is this red bush in Africa. That's great tea also, and it's medicine. And that's the beautiful thing about almost all this is all of it is true medicine. You think it's just tea, but it's medicine, unless we mess it up. And then pure is really good. Pur. So Kellen says, what's pur? Pur, the people that can't afford things, they're the pur. No. So I drank this when I was doing a cooking show, and I don't remember exactly what it was. Does anybody drink that? It's PU-ERH. And I want to say it has like more caffeine in it, if I remember correctly. So help me if you guys drink that or you know what it is. I like when you guys ask me stuff I don't know. I'd only drink that once. And I've only seen it once in a place, so it's not a very common one. So the other thing is, the manufacturing. So also the grading of tea. So typically most people don't think about the grading, but you'll see people talk about how Lipton is like kind of like the floor sweepings, the garbage tea. And there's a whole grading system they use that's like P and OP and OP, no, that's a song from the 80s. FOP, GFOP, and so there's all these things, and it's just the quality and the size and the shape and all these things. So Pekoe or Pekoe, which is PEKOE, that's kind of your small, short leaves, the kind of crappier stuff. Then you have the orange version, and then you have flowery orange, which is better. It's longer, but not as tightly rolled. But then, like, flowery broken orange, that's the flowery orange that's broken up. So your best one, if I remember right, is the Tippy Golden Flower Orange Pekoe. So it's TGFOP grading. So I don't know. Occasionally you'll see this. I only see, when I look on the package, you'll occasionally see, like, Pekoe, or you'll see Orange Pekoe. Orange Pekoe. Otherwise, I don't really see much of the other ones on there. But if you go to like a tea shop, you may see those gradings of the tea. And it's usually just based on the length of it, whether it's damaged. That's typically how they break that up. But there's about maybe 12 different types of grading for it. So. Okay, so who says this one? So Christy, she says, other than being addictive, is caffeine bad? So caffeine in small amounts has good effects. Just like coffee. I mean, coffee is really high caffeine. But there's good and there's bad caffeine. And really the good is I drink small amounts once in a while because they're part of something that I really enjoy, right? So once in a while, if you do drink a yerba mate, or once in a while, if you drink too much green tea, it's not a big deal. But what happens for most Americans is most Americans by about 35 are just hormonally exhausted. So there's not an amount of caffeine, nicotine, sugar, wheat, dairy that's going to make them feel good anymore. And so during that journey till about 35, what most people are doing is as hormones suck, they just use caffeine as a drug. And so it's legal, why not get jacked up on it? And so it starts with like, green tea, then maybe black tea, then coffee, then a couple coffees, then a pot of coffee. But what's amazing is when people get change their lifestyle stuff, they will go to, I can't imagine a world without a pot of coffee, to, holy crap, I forgot my coffee this week. And so all it becomes, that. So Christy, the answer to the question is, the only problem is when we use it to basically minimize the effects of our hormones being depleted, if that makes sense. So, and then, so Suzanne says puree, I don't think I'm saying it right. is microbial fermented tea. So instead of being fermented from the sun, they use bacteria to do it, then they dry and they roll it. And then Tim, same thing, you know, talks about that it's fermented. And so it's from a specific province in China. So although it's fermented, it's not like kombucha tea where it's a living tea. It's just fermented to oxidize or to change it, but not really. So it'll change the flavor of it. It'll change the tannins maybe and the vitamin content of it, but probably not the, but it's not an active living thing, right? So like kombucha is living. So one other thing too that I learned about tea during that seminar is that, is that you can use your two tea bags twice, or even three times. So with tea, since it truly is just, it's just herbal medicine, it's just take a bunch of leaves, chop them up, and that's tea, right? The first brew, if you do that 1 to 2 minutes, you can put those back in the freezer, and you can use those again. So often, I'll have like one new tea bag, and then I'll have one old tea bag. And the second tea, you get actually a little bit more medicinal effects from that. And so it's great to have that double benefit from that. And then you're also kind of saving money because you can use that tea bag two or three times. But what you can also do is in my freezer, I have a little bowl. And I will take that tea bag, open it up, and put it in that bowl. And then I keep it in there. And then occasionally when I make soups and sauces and stews, I will throw that tea in there. And so it doesn't change the flavor, but it adds another layer of medicine or medicinal effects into your food. So that's one of those ways that, like, if you're going to buy a good tea, great. Use it two or three times, put it in your food, make it medicine. So I hope that helps too. I think that's a really awesome way to do that. And then Deborah, it reduces bad cholesterol, lowers triglycerides. Yeah, and tea, I mean, really, puree teas like that, I think it's puer or something. But, yeah, I mean, there is lots of benefits. And so, you know, women actually have higher risk of heart attacks now than men for the first time in history. But 3 to 5 cups of tea actually reduce the risk of cardiovascular disease by 50%. That's huge in a country where you're more likely to have a heart attack than I am. And then what's the the Chinese studies through Shenzhen University? They show that drinking green tea is a clot buster. So it literally breaks up clots before they can be heart attacks and strokes. So something like black tea would be more oxidizing, so it might end up causing more clots, where green tea is going to bust up clots and prevent deep vein thrombosis and then also heart attack and stroke. So it's amazing. But it's not... And the other thing with tea... And you see this with red wine. So half the world drinks red wine, the other half drinks green tea. But part of green tea is slowing yourself down. So if you get a cold green tea, you can chug that in the car and you're fine. You don't need to be around anybody. You don't need to slow down. You can do it. You can just go, 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 right? Part of the benefit of tea, though, is tea is traditionally really hot. And so if you have a hot tea, you can't be driving around with that, usually. And it makes you sip it slowly and take your time. That's why when I go to like Japanese restaurants or something like that, I always like to get that hot thing of green tea because you can't even hold that cup, right? So you just kind of warm your hands a little bit and take a little tiny sip and a little tiny sip. And what you do, whether you know it or not, is you slow down. And when you slow down, you drop your cortisol levels. You start becoming more mindful and more fully present. And those are little tiny things that dramatically change your hormone content. Dramatically. And it doesn't seem like much, but it's a huge change. Just like when you drink red wine, you usually can't chug it, but you have to kind of sip. But you can take a Zinfandel or a Riesling and just chug that whole bottle. Boone's Farm. Right? So that's one of the benefits of drinking hot tea in a little cup in, you know, ceramic or glass to where you can't really... do it on the go, if that makes sense. So yeah, if you're driving green tea, driving and you have green tea in a thermos, yeah, it's beneficial. But you really want the social hormonal benefit of that too. Sarah says hi. Hi. Let me see. There's a few more questions here. Alex says hi. So Christy, let's see. Do the tannins in tea interfere with iron absorption? So yeah, great question. And this is where food becomes so complicated in America, but not the rest of the entire freaking world. So you read all these things where it's like, don't eat these things because they'll interfere with thyroid, but they're all super healthy. Don't eat these because they'll interfere with digestion, but they're super healthy. Don't eat these because they can cause problems with diverticulitis, but they're super healthy. And so the question always becomes, if it's true, then it's true among the healthiest, happiest, longest living populations. And if it's not true among them, then it's not true. And the reality is, tannins have huge benefits. And if you eat fruits and vegetables and nuts and seeds and berries and greens, you're going to get all the iron absorption you need. And so there's things that interfere and then there's things that promote. And your life should be balanced with those things. And so where we demonize one food, we end up eliminating all its other benefits. And if people go through and, like, I got, what's that book called? Digestive Health with Real Food, right? Sounds like a good book. But if you follow the advice of the whole book, from FODMAPs to saponins to lectins, you can't eat a damn thing. And so it's ridiculous, because that's not what the healthiest, happiest populations do. That's not what animals do, right? So with tea, the tea is way more benefit than risk. And if you eat oranges and citrus, you're going to get all the iron you need from your greens and other food too. So don't worry about that, as long as you eat real, actual food. And then Tim asked about kombucha. Okay, so that went bad. So let's see. Kombucha is made from green tea, have the same benefits of green tea, more or less. So kombucha is fermented, but it doesn't have to be green tea. So sometimes it's black tea, green tea, white tea, herbal tea, like hibiscus or something like that. The whole purpose of kombucha is you get 5 beneficial bacteria, 10 beneficial yeasts, and 20 beneficial acids. And so those really change what can and cannot live in your gut. And where one of your cells should be protected by 10 bacterial cells, we are 9 times bacteria, 1 part human. So we need this constant fermentation of food and drinks. And most Americans don't do that. So fermentation of those teas are wonderfully beneficial. If you use green tea, you know, it's like a gallon of water with 6 green tea bags. Add a cup of organic sugar, honey, or molasses. And then you put your SCOBY in there and a little bit, about a cup of kombucha. And that'll ferment that eats that sugar and makes acid. So when it's finally done, it's only medicinal at that point. And yeah, so Tim, the question is it the green tea beneficial? It's hugely beneficial there. And I have my hotel of SCOBYs too. You guys want to see them? I'm going to bring them. Just a second. In case you guys haven't ever seen these. So that's a SCOBY hotel for kombucha. So this isn't really what you'd make for kombucha, but this is just a whole bunch of these symbiotic colonies, bacteria and yeast. So this is what you'd make kombucha with. So like, I'm going to make, I have a workshop on Saturday where I'm going to a company and making that kombucha. But see, it makes these little discs. Like, here's a little baby, right? So that little baby, it grew up in the small little top of this, so it's small. But otherwise, they're usually pretty big like this. So they'll grow whatever size the jar is. So it's really good. So you take one of those and you put them in there, and then that ferments and makes green tea. It might look a little gross, but it's awesome. And now, now I smell like kombucha. So I'm going to go down to the Whole Foods, and I'm going to have a bunch of hipsters hitting on me. Probably the guys and girls. They're going to be like, is that kombucha I smell? Like that. It's like an aphrodisiac for hippies. All right, so what's good kombucha? So Deborah, you know, like any of them are good kombuchas. So there's GT. It's actually made with love, so that's kind of nice. In Wichita, there's actually a company made called Krabby Cat. I don't know if it's called Krabby Cat, but they make Krabby Cat kombucha, and I love their lime coconut one. It's the bomb. So like every time I go to Beautiful Day Cafe, that's what I try to get is the Krabby Cat. And they actually sell it at Mead's Corner too. It's an awesome one. So really just kind of try different ones and find out what you like. Now they're $3 to $5 a bottle. But if you make your own, it's only 10 cents a bottle. It's crazy dirt cheap. You just have to get over the weirdness of what it looks like. So, and if you guys ever want, if you know, you have a group of people that want to do a kombucha workshop, I love doing those. So, I don't charge for those at all. And usually I have lots of extra moms, mothers or scobies that we can give away to. So, people bring their own jar and their own cup of sugar. And super easy to make. Super easy to make. Super dirt cheap. So Zoe says, I like putting tinctures in my tea, like echinacea and golden seal or astragalus. So that's a good idea too. You know, that herbal tea mixed with the green tea, that's like extra benefit. And again, astragalus is just an herb. Golden seal is an herb. Echinacea is an herb. So those by themselves are tea. But adding those with green tea is wildly beneficial. So that's an awesome idea. I love mixing teas. I love taking if anybody has like urinary tract problems, like leakage, dribbling, like raspberry leaf tea is the bomb, but it doesn't taste all that great. So you put that with a green tea, or if you don't like the taste of green tea, throw a pomegranate tea in there with it. And so then you're getting the benefit of one thing, whether it's the flavor, but then you're also getting the medicinal effect of the other tea in there. So I like that idea, putting herbal with your green tea. So the other question there, if I'm putting herbal tinctures in there, in the hot tea, does it make it more bioavailable? I mean, by the time, if you put in there, the tincture by itself, you could put under your tongue and absorb directly into your bloodstream. If you put it in there, it goes into your stomach, into the acid, and then stays for, depending on if you're eating with it, 2 to 4 hours. Drops down, first 18 inches of your small intestine is where you get most of your absorption. So tinctures probably under the tongue is the most medicinal way of getting those if you really want them. But putting them in the tea is perfectly fine. So it just maybe takes a little bit more time to absorb. So any other questions? So, man, we go through this fast. This is crazy fast. Let me see if there's other things in here too. Time of steeping will depend on whether it's too bitter or not. So don't worry about it. If you have tea and it's too bitter, just look at the time that you're doing, right? So the temperature and the amount of time that you steep it is what determines whether it's bitter or not. The other thing is leaf expansion. So if you get like gunpowder tea or they roll it up, right? I love those. And then you put those in a little, you can put them in a tea sock, which is always nice. Or you can put it, or if you're hiking, you just put it in a sock. And then you can also put them in those little kind of little traps where they close like that and you put it in the tea. The only thing about that is often, like when I first did, I'd put way too much in there. But you want about, with the tea, it's going to expand about 3 to 5 times its size. So you really don't need much in there when you steep it. So making sure you don't put way too much in, knowing that it's going to expand. And so it's whole leaf kind of thing. So what else have we not talked about? Let's see. Kel-Ann, what about adding more theanine? Well, theanine plus that little bit of caffeine, the 15 to 30 milligrams, or 15 to 25 milligrams, literally makes you smarter and your brain work better. So I don't know if I would add more theanine. I mean, theanine's going to be created through a process, so it's better to get it naturally where it's synergistic already with that food. So when it comes to tea, it's going to have that perfect blend right there. And so I wouldn't worry too much about doing that, although you might find research says it's better for you. I don't know. So. And then Christy says, I used to make kombucha at home, but every time I drank it, I had to sneeze. So, yeah. Commercial kombucha doesn't do that to you. Huh. Well, the commercial one might be black tea, and maybe you're making it with green tea, and you have a sensitivity to green tea. I was having those coughing bits that I used to get from coffee, but I was getting them after a quick coffee. So I did that food sensitivity test, and it ended up being green tea. And sure enough, every time I drink green tea, I started getting that little tickle in my throat and coughing and stuff. So it might be that. And then it also might be just that it's more acidic when you're making it at home, depending on how strong you make it or what type of fruit that you use. Basically, it's going to be what you're doing at home probably makes the difference. So, and then you might have a sensitivity to a tea versus what they use, maybe black tea. And then Deborah Dupree, so can you get elderberry in a tea? And you should. You know, they should, at that place in Mulvane, they should be making elderberry kombucha. That would be pretty dope. They make elderberry wine. But you can get elderberry. Elderberry grows like crazy in Kansas. Like it's too much if you're growing it. But elderberry tea, I bet they have. I bet they have that. So, and you know, when I make kombucha, sometimes I'll start with like elderberry tea bags, or say hibiscus tea bags, or some medicinal tea bag, and not just green tea. So sometimes that's more beneficial to do it that way if you have, say, green tea sensitivities like I do. And never do decaffeinated. Decaffeinated, they use acetones and high heat to break off that caffeine molecule. So if it's green, black, white, oolong, you know, it has tea, has caffeine naturally occurring in there. So they use toxic chemicals to break that off. But you will see naturally decaffeinated tea that's herbal tea that never had caffeine in there. That's perfectly fine. Just don't drink tea where they artificially take it out. So, and then with tea also, you're getting flavanols in there like catechins and epigallic acid. Those literally change DNA. Proanthocyanamides or PCAs, those are antihistamines, which then decrease allergies and asthma and autoimmune conditions. Other flavanols like quercetin that's in there is an anti-edema, anti-inflammatory. So most people don't think when I'm drinking green tea that I'm knocking down pain and inflammation with that. There's also malvedin that's in there, that's a proanthocyanamide. The phenolic acids that are in there, gallic hydroxycinnamic acid, those are really good too. Those help reverse heart disease, which is awesome. And then resveratrol is actually in tea, and that reverses heart disease. So it doesn't have to be red wine, but green tea is actually reverses cardiovascular disease the same way. Oh, good. So Prairie Harvest, you know, yeah, if they have elderberry tea, that's awesome. And then Suzanne says, where can we make specific tea blends in our area? So you can do that at home. Remember, anything herbal is just a leaf and roots you can put in there. You can have turmeric tea, right? You can have ginger tea. Those are roots. So anything you do, where you mix medicinal things together, it's all tea, right? So that would be pretty cool, maybe having like a little tea party. We could have it in Boston, but a little tea party where we kind of mix and match and try different things too, kind of like we do with kombucha. I mean, kombucha I love because, you know, you basically like, let's try this thing in there, let's try this thing in there, let's try this thing in there. And that's kind of what you do, is you kind of mix and match and make these different medicinal blends. And, you know, try different things like that. So that's a good question. When it comes to polyphenols, 2 cups of tea is the same as 1 glass of red wine. So basically, again, like we said, half the country drinks red wine, half drink tea. But when it comes to free radical research, that's where those 2 cups of tea or 1 glass of red wine truly becomes very powerful medicine in reversing inflammatory diseases. So Suzanne, I don't know. You know, Zoe might have a good answer for that, because I know she did some tea training too. But who would come to our new tea blend business? What does that mean? We should That I think they have like there's a that local one in town. You think they'd probably do something like that? And then Christy says matcha is my favorite. Yeah, I love matcha. So the caffeine kick is somewhat sustained. So that's one of those things with green tea, that subtle caffeine is that little bit. When you get to 15, 25 milligrams caffeine, you get that brain boost, energy boost, but you don't get a crash like you will with black tea and coffee. So that's a huge difference. So nobody's like jacked up, like just, I can't pull it together because I drank too much green tea this morning. But they will be that with black tea. They'll just be like, oh, why the hell do I gotta get the hell out of here, right? So when they drink that like 44 ounce of black tea or something like from Sonic, that becomes a big issue. So a couple things too. There was research that showed that 5 cups of green tea, now that's quite a bit, but it lowered all disease by 16%. All disease. And 3 cups was 11%, which is pretty dope because they said if you walk, was it 10 minutes or do any kind of exercise for 10 minutes, that lowers your risk of all disease by 10%. So then you throw in some green tea in there, 20%, that's huge, right? And when you look at the healthiest, happiest, longest living populations, it's not rocket science what they do at all. They just do these things that are consistent with life longevity. And then when you look at the research always backs it up and says, yeah, that's what they do, right? That's how it works. So Zoe says, Abby with Cozy Leaf Blend is the one that inspired her to make these. So they do customer requests. So that would be really good there, right? So that way you could say, I want a blend of this and that. I went to the spice merchant and I thought they would have. I don't know. I expected a lot more there than I saw, but maybe I just had higher. I don't know. Maybe I expect in my head I had a vision of what it would be like. But yeah. So customizing herbal blends would be great. I think you know that's a good idea, especially when you know you're talking about women have higher risk of heart disease, heart attacks, strokes, cancer. But yet something as simple as tea makes a huge impact on reversing that. I mean, that's a daily simple thing that you can do. And then green tea, the research shows it raises your HDLs, your good cholesterol, which prevents heart attack and stroke, which is awesome. And really, the more green tea that people drank had a greater impact on balancing out cholesterol. And then the polyphenols blocked excess bad cholesterol or inflammatory cholesterol. So there's no bad cholesterol, but like the LDL type B, those ones are repairing damage. So again, part of what green tea does is knock that damage down, so then you need less. Another really interesting thing, I think I mentioned this too, was research shows that green tea makes us smarter. So our findings suggest that green tea increases short-term synaptic plasticity in the brain, similar to what you see with like yoga, meditation, and mindfulness. And the L-theanine in there has a synergistic effect with that caffeine, making it potent for improving brain function. And so they do these PET scans where people drink green tea, and then they look at blood flow to certain parts of the brain, and it dramatically increases that blood flow to the parts of the brain, which is going to help you be more effective at work. So that's one of those things of saying, like, you know, if you're a boss, making sure that you have green tea for your employees, not black tea. Black tea is going to make them more brain foggy, where green tea is going to make them more effective. And so the same people are coming to the same job, but you're getting a whole different productivity benefit from that, which is amazing. They think they said the average American is only productive 15 minutes out of every hour they're at work. Otherwise, they're just all jacked up, you know? So their hormones suck because life sucks because Americans love fear and anxiety. We exhaust the hormones and we use caffeine to get jacked up so we can cope. But then people just are not productive. And then they go home and they just sit and stare at the screens and stuff. Christy says, is there something about tea that can irritate bladder? So typically it shouldn't. And if you do like a raspberry leaf tea, it actually should strengthen bladder function. But you might have some that are irritating to the bladder, just like you have some that are irritating. Like black tea, yes. Green tea, it shouldn't be. But black tea, there's enough caffeine in there. It should cause reflux and urinary urgency, leakage, dribbling, those kind of things. So, same with coffee. And then, green tea increases what are called alpha waves. And those are the relaxing waves that are produced during meditation. So, when you're drinking that hot green tea, it truly is relaxing you at the metabolic level, at the brain level. And there's other research that we pulled together that green tea reverses or prevents cancer. So it lowers breast cancer by 22%, prostate cancer by 48%, and then it lowered colon cancer by 57%. I mean, that's huge, huge numbers for one specific thing. And what happens is we have all this free radical damage, and green tea has that all those polyphenols, ipecacolic acid, which actually prevents DNA damage. And then let alone the theophylline, and that reverses DNA mutation too. So it helps restore normal DNA. Let's see. So Sarah, what are the benefits of chasteberry tea? So chasteberry tea is really interesting. So it's from chasteberries, which is like a bush in England. And used to, they thought it would cause women to be chaste or infertile. But really what it does is it helps balance out. It's a very subtle way to balance out hormonal imbalances. So for women that have infertility, PMS, postmenopause syndrome, all those kind of things, it's a very subtle way to balance that out. It's a really great tea. It's also called Vitex Cactus Agnus. So sometimes you'll see it as Vitex tea, sometimes you'll see it as chasteberry tea. But that's a good point, Sarah. So that's a great tea. And that's another one that you can add in with your green tea to get double benefits. So another really great research article had talked about all the benefits of green tea. And really, it was antioxidant, so it knocks down all this inflammatory stuff. It's anti-inflammatory specific, so it knocks down like interleukin-12 and NFKB, P38, and so dramatically changing the inflammatory properties. I had been talking all day. Anti-proliferative. And so basically it has all these benefits where it knocks down inflammatory processes that allow cancer to proliferate. It's anti-thrombolytic, which we talked about, so it actually knocks down and breaks apart clots, which we talked about the Zhejiang University studies. It's a vasorelaxation, so same thing as alpha waves in the brain. It also then releases nitrous oxide, which then dilates blood vessels and calms and relaxes people. And one of the really great things, it's one of the most powerful anti-angiogenic things that we can do. So it decreases vascular endothelial growth factor, which is what allows blood vessels to grow for cancer to survive. So we constantly want to be knocking that down. And a lot of foods that we consume are more beneficial than the medicines to knock down vascular growth for cancer. So it's called anti-angiogenic, which is based off like Dr. David Lee, L.I., his research, how to starve cancer with food. So really great stuff. So, all right, I think we're running out of time. Oh, we went past. Okay, so if you guys have more questions, feel free to post these. If you're watching this later, feel free to post questions. I try to go back and answer them. I think I'm the last one I haven't answered those questions. But I'll go back and answer those. So, and if I forget, tell me to answer those. But please share this. Please like it. I'm glad you guys joined. It's really just, I love doing these. So I hope you guys get benefit out of these. And there's like 80 other shows that you can watch. And feel free to join us next week for the next show. And if you have different ideas of things that you want. So I thought next week we ought to do like cold remedies or flu remedies. That would probably be pretty good. So I think we did one a few months ago, maybe, or a month and a half ago, on vaccine ingredients. So when you get the flu shot, it talks about all the crap that's in there. So that was a pretty interesting one. There's a lot of really great ones that we've done over the years. But Feel free to post of stuff you want to hear about coming up. And also, we'll probably do the non... So people make their resolutions for the year, but it's usually bull crap. So we don't want to do that gimmicky... We want a non-resolution. We want a lifestyle change, a sustainable change for the next year, right? So glad you guys joined. Thank you guys so much for being a part of this. And I look forward to seeing you guys next week. Thanks.